So this is a book reading of the book The Peter Principle, written by Dr. Lawrence J. Peter and Raymond Hull. Chapter 1 and chapter 2 are already uploaded on my channel. Please, if you are interested, please go and check them out. I will link them in the pin bar. Chapter 3 of the book The Peter Principle, Apparent Exceptions. Many people to whom I mentioned the Peter Principle do not want to accept it. They anxiously search for and sometimes think they have found flaws in my hierarchological structure. So at this point, I want to issue a warning. Do not be fooled by apparent exceptions. Apparent exception number 1. The persuasive sublimation. What about Walt Bocklet's promotion? He was hopelessly incompetent and bottlenecked, so management kicked him upstairs to get him out of the road. I often hear such questions. Let's example this phenomenon. When I have named the persuasive sublimation, did Bocklet move from a position of incompetence to a position of competence? No. He has simply been moved from one unproductive position to another. Does he now undertake any greater responsibility than before? No. Does he accomplish any more work in the new position than he did in the old? No. The persuasive sublimation is a pseudo-promotion. Some blockhead-type employees actually believe that they have received a genuine promotion. Others recognize the truth. But the main function of pseudo-promotion is to deceive people outside the hierarchy. When this is achieved, the maneuver is counted as a success. But the experienced hierarchologist will never be deceived. Hierarchologically, the only move that we can accept as a genuine promotion is a move from a level of competence. What is the effect of a successful persuasive sublimation? Assume that Bocklet's employer is still competent. Then by moving Bocklet, he achieves 3 goals. He camouflages the ill success of his promotion policy. To admit that Bocklet was incompetent would lead observers to think Kickley should have realized before giving Bocklet that last promotion that Bocklet wasn't the man for the job. But a persuasive sublimation justifies the previous promotion in the eyes of employees and onlookers, not to a hierarchologist. He supports staff morale. Some employees at least will think, if Bocklet can get a promotion, I can get a promotion. One persuasive sublimation serves a carrot on a stick to many other employees. Third, he maintains the hierarchy. Even though Bocklet is incompetent, he must not be fired. He probably knows enough of Kickley's business to be dangerous in a competitive hierarchy. A common phenomenon. Hierarchology tells us that every thriving organization will be characterized by this accumulation of deadwood at the executive level, consistent of persuasive sublimities and potential candidate for persuasive sublimation. One well-known appliance manufacturing firm has 23 vice presidents. A paradoxical result. The Waverly Broadcasting Corporation is noted for the creativity of its production department. This is made possible through persuasive sublimation. Waverly has just moved all its non-creative, non-productive, redundant personnel into a partial $3 million head office complex. The head office contains no cameras, microphones, or transmitters. Indeed, it is miles away from the nearest studio. The people at the head office are always frantically busy drawing up reports and flowcharts and making appointments to confer with one another. Recently, a reshuffle of senior officials was announced, aimed at streamlining the headquarters operations. 4 vice presidents were replaced by 8 vice presidents and a corporation assistant to the president. So we see that the persuasive sublimation can serve to keep the drones out of the hair of workers. Apparent exception number 2, the lateral arabesque. Lateral arabesque is another pseudo-promotion, without being raised in rank, sometimes without even a pay raise. The incompetent employee is given a new and longer title and is moved to an office in a remote part of the building. R. Filewood proved incompetent as office manager of Radical Stationery. After a lateral arabesque, he found himself at the same salary working as a coordinator of interdepartmental communications, supervising the filing of second copies of inter-office memos. Automotive Manufacturing File, Case Number 8. Wheeler Automobile Parts Limited has developed the lateral arabesque more fully than most hierarchies. The Wheeler operation are divided into many regions, and at last count I found that 25 senior executives had been banished to the province as regional vice presidents. The company bought a motel and ordered one senior officer to go and run it. Another redundant vice president had been laboring for 3 years to write the company's history. I conclude that the larger the hierarchy, the easier is the lateral arabesque. A case of levitation, the entire 82-man staff of a small government department was moved away to another department, leaving the director at $16,000 a year with nothing to do and nobody to supervise. Here we see that rare phenomenon of hierarchical pyramid consisting solely of the capstone suspended aloft without a base to support it. This interesting condition I denominate the free-floating apex. Apparent exception number 3, Peter's inversion. A friend of mine was traveling in a country where the sale of alcoholic beverages is a government monopoly. Just before returning home, he went to a government liquor store and asked, "How much liquor am I allowed to take back home with me?" "You'll have to ask the customs officer at the border," said the clerk. "But I want to know now," said the traveler, "so that I can buy all the liquor that is permissible and yet not buy too much and get some of it confiscated." "It's a customs regulation," replied the clerk. "It's nothing to do with us." "But surely you know the customs regulation," said the traveler. "Yes, I know it," said the clerk, "but customs regulations are not as responsibility of this department, so I'm not allowed to tell you." Have you ever had a similar experience? Ever been told we don't give out this information? The official knows the answer to your problem. You know that he knows it, but for some reason or other, he won't tell you. Once taking a professorship at a new university, I received a special identification card issued by the payroll department of the university, entitling me to cash checks at the university bookstore. I went to the store, presented my card, and proffered a $20 American Express traveler's check. "We only cash payroll checks and personal checks," said the bookstore cashier. "But this is better than a personal check," I said. "It's better even than a payroll check. I can cash this in any store even without this special card. A traveler's check is as good as cash." "But it's not a payroll check or a personal check," said the cashier. After a little more discussion, I asked to see the manager. He listened to me patiently, but with a faraway expression, then stated flatly, "We do not cash traveler's check." You have heard of hospitals who spend precious times filing in shelves of forms before helping accident victims. You have heard of nurses who says, "Wake up, it's time to take your sleeping pills." You may have heard of Irish man Michael Patrick O'Brien, who was kept for 11 months on a ferry boat flying between Hong Kong and Macau. He did not have the correct papers to get off at either of the trip, and nobody would issue him, particularly among minor officials with no powers. One sees an obscene concern with getting forms filled out correctly. Whether the forms serve any useful purpose or not, no deviation, however slightly, from the customary routine will be permitted. Professional automatism. The above type of behavior are called professional automatism. To the professional automaton, it is clear that means are no important than ends. The paperwork is more important than the purpose of for which it was originally designed. He no longer sees himself as existing to serve the public. He sees the public as the raw material that serves to maintain him. The forms, the rituals, and the hierarchy. The professional automaton, from the viewpoint of his customers, clients, or victims, seems incompetent. So you will no doubt be wondering, how do so many professional automatons win promotions? And is the professional automaton outside the operation of Peter Principle? To answer this question, I must first pose another. Who defines competence? A question of standards. The competence of an employee is determined not by outsiders, but by the supervisor in the hierarchy. If the superior is still at the level of competence, he may evaluate his subordinates in terms of the performance of useful work, for example, the supply of medicine services or information, the production of sausages or table legs, or achieving whatever are the stated aims of the hierarchy. That is to say, he evaluates output. But if the supervisor has reached his level of incompetence, he will probably rate his subordinates in terms of institutional values. He will see competence as the behavior that supports the rules, rituals, and forms of the statutes. Promptness, neatness, courtesy to superiors, internal paperwork will be highly regarded. In short, such an official evaluates input. Rockman is dependable. Luke Burke contributes to the smooth running of the office. Rutter is methodical. Miss Truden is a steady, consistent worker. In such instances, internal consistency is valued more highly than effective service. This is Peter's inversion. A professional automaton may also be termed as Peter's invert. He has inverted the means-end relationship. Now you can understand the action of the Peter's inverts described earlier. If the liquor store clerk has promptly explained the customs regulations, the traveler would have thought, how courteous. But the superior would have marked the clerk down for breaking a rule of the department. If the bookstore cashier had accepted my traveler's check, I would have considered him helpful. The manager would have reprimanded him for exceeding his authority. Promotion prospects for Peter's inverts. The Peter's invert, or professional automation, has, as we have seen, little capacity for independent judgment. He always obeys, never decides. This, from the viewpoint of the hierarchy, is competence. So the Peter's invert is eligible for a promotion. He will continue to rise unless some mischance places him in a post where he has to make decisions. Here he will find his level of incompetence. There are two kinds of minor decisions which I have sometimes seen made by promoted Peter's inverts. To tighten up on enforcement of regulations, to make new regulations covering a marginal case which does not exactly fit existing regulations. These actions only serve to strengthen the inversion. We see therefore that professional automations, however annoying you may have found them, it is not after all an exception to the Peter's principle. As I often tell my students, competence is like truth, beauty on contact lenses. It is in the eye of the beholder. Here I may take a break and maybe upload the second part of the chapter 3 later, because this video might get too long. I just want to keep my videos 10 minutes. So yeah, thank you for listening so far. I appreciate you. Thank you for watching. Bye.